studied abroad in Japan at Tokyo Christian University. Living in another country for over 3 months brought many different experiences, oftentimes challenging ones. The following is a collection of poems that I have written after reflecting on some of these experiences that remain fresh in my memory a year later. Origami pumpkins on Halloween. I grip the small potted plant, a gift for my host family, as we drive through the outskirts of Tokyo. At Costco, a woman offers samples. Instead of fruit, chips, or dip, it is orange salmon, raw and succulent. My host mother picks out a baby octopus for dinner. Her young daughters run to find more groceries, and I am running just as fast in my mind as it reels from their excited questions in Japanese. Lunch is homemade spaghetti made by my host father in the small but shockingly clean apartment. The girls show me to my room, two thick futon mattresses on my bed. I am shown the bathroom, or ofuro. It has a short, deep tub, and I am already looking forward to my hot bath later that night. One showers first, then climbs into the tub. That afternoon, the girls show me how to make origami jackknives until we join the neighborhood children walking from house to house in the dusk, wind, and cold. The origami pumpkins are traded for treats, Kit Kats, chocolate, strawberry, and green tea flavor, chips, and dry powdered ice cream in a wafer cone. Dinner, everything is washoku, traditional Japanese food. The octopus is freshly prepared and put into a yellow batter. It pools into the bowl-shaped holes of the black griddle. 7-year-old Yui helps me make these crispy golden balls. Grandfather gives me two cards. One is of a persimmon, the other a Chinese begonia. Scenes from his garden, which he captured in watercolor. Come see us again, he says. On the back of each card, the names of each family member, written in delicate calligraphy. Grandfather speaks in English, and I try my best in Japanese. The table holds the most sushi I've ever seen at one time. My favorite is the golden sea urchin that crowns a small bed of rice. There is more salmon, rose-colored tuna, and bright orange caviar wrapped in seaweed. Everyone is reverent at the table, and Yui's younger sister prays. The brain works harder, always, when others do not speak one's native language. The mind cannot rest as often. But now, as I sit at the table with my host family, a warm happiness has seeped into my soul. I cannot understand each word, but I listen, and I grasp tightly with my heart to the warmth that is there. Red suitcase. As I carry your red suitcase, panic starts to pour into me as you hurry behind with the dorm director half hungry. You are trying very, very hard not to cry. Minutes ago, you stuffed anything you could find into the small shape of that suitcase. I had woken to the sound of your voice, struggling with emotion. Meanwhile, the dorm director breaks the news to me in English. She tells me that your father is dying. Weeks before, as we walked through the park on a warm night, you told me that he was in the hospital. Like usual, we spoke in Japanese, but I was disappointed to find that I could not understand everything you said. Still, I could feel sadness and warmth that you were my roommate and becoming my good friend. We sang a hymn underneath that cloudy sky. It is well with my soul. Now the dorm director quietly asks me to leave the curb. You and the school van disappear. Everyone is in a rush, but I can only stand and then go inside and sit stunned in our room. Only now do I finally understand that word, gone, cancer. You said it in the dark, and now it burns brightly in my mind like your red suitcase. Wet concrete. A dreariness No moon, just the fuzziness of the cloudy night sky. Rain drips down my forehead and splatters my glasses. I jump inside of myself when I see a figure hunched over on a wooden bench under a single yellow light. I do not change pace, and I do not say anything, but I continue to walk by. The fear evaporates, but a sadness fills its place. Sadness, like the wet concrete and asphalt that my shoes scrape as I maneuver around the puddles. I came to this park to pace, to figure out the changes, what's different from home, and what's the same. For now, I am feeling the more difficult emotions that can come with culture shock. It has trickled in gradually, but tonight I am weighed down. Even the man I pass by cannot look up as if his black coat is too heavy. The next five poems are written in the haiku style. Haiku is a form of Japanese poetry. Each poem has three lines, and each line has a set meter. The first line has five syllables, the second line, seven syllables, and the third line, five syllables. Heron. Through the green, a cry, the gray heron by the pond sees me, disappears. Morning jog. Rice paddies swallow the morning rain. Our shoes slide and squish in the mud. Wednesdays. Happy students fill cafeteria seats. There's curry rice for lunch. Photo. An abandoned bike surrounded by bamboo shoots behind Buddhist graves. Winter blossoms. In winter, there's one cherry tree filled with blossoms, white in the night sky. Mount Fuji, or Fuji-san, is a sacred Japanese mountain revered in the Shinto and Buddhist faiths. It is an active volcano, and many Japanese make pilgrimages to Fuji's summit. There is a Japanese saying, "He who climbs Mount Fuji once is a wise man. He who climbs it twice is a fool." Mount Fuji. Skin remembers the cold. Shiver and notice the red rocks, the piercing starlight, space and rhythms of breath, white breath escaping hundreds of pairs of lungs. Ears remember footsteps, step, slide, step, slide, up thousands of feet of mountain gravel, voices against a vast silence, a stranger's encouragement, spoken in English, hushed conversations in Japanese, the jingling bells on pilgrim's clothes, nose and mouth filled with numbing cold, then the steam and taste of corn soup, then numbing cold. The mind is shouting, protesting the cold. Long hours pass, and we know, before the sun comes the moon, before the heat, the cold, before comfort, endurance, before compassion, suffering. Fu in Fuji means love. The frigid wind reminds me this. I am dressed in layers, but the pilgrims are not. Pilgrims, maybe they are praying. I pray, too. We keep climbing, and then there are no trees, no vegetation or animal life, only the rushing wind and the black mountain, and all of us, and God. The heart remembers love. It rests with us on the hard, cold rocks. It speaks through a stranger's encouraging words. Love slows its pace when a friend is tired. It is shared in jackets and food and water. It helps others when they slip and fall. It bellows with hundreds of voices, cheering as the sun comes up. Eyes wide on the sun, his red visage, it cuts across the white sky. Minutes, seconds, and I can see. Black sky becomes blue, then orange, followed by white.
Oh, that I have written?
No.
Yeah.
I hope someday to be able to do that.
Which of those poems is your favorite?
I
say probably my favorite, or the one that I hold most dearest to me, is the red suitcase, because it was the one I wrote first about my roommate and our relationship.
Did you share the haiku poems with your Japanese host?
No, I have not shared them with my Japanese host. Maybe I will write a letter and send them.
That's good.
You can say, my professor said I should do this. So you lived in a dorm, but then you referred to a host family. So did you visit a host family, and they had a weird connection there, or how did that work?
So part of our study abroad program for this East Asia Institute semester abroad program is that each student is paired up with a local